start. We're running a little bit behind, but that's okay. We actually, one of our groups, the Wyoming SAD group that was featured this morning, one student, his car broke down, and so they went to go back and get it. So hopefully they get in here by the end of the session before 2:15. So we'll let them kind of have the end to talk about some of the stuff they do. But like, I guess the try this slogan goes, we go with the flow. Which is great. But welcome, thank you guys so much for coming to this session. I'm really excited about this. And I'll just introduce myself first before asking each of the groups, the youth groups, youth-led and adult-sponsored groups that are here, talk a little bit about what they're about. My name is Liz Brunello, and I'm with the American Friends Service Committee. So my whole program overall is called the Appalachian Center for Equality. And we have three different youth programs at three different high schools in Boone, Logan, and Mingo counties. And I have the pleasure of having my Mingo students and Logan students here, some outstanding student leaders from those two groups. And what we're about is the, you know, civic engagement that we're all trying to do in our communities with a health promotion focus, as well as like college preparedness and advocacy leadership. So these guys do a lot of different stuff, so it's a little hard to put into a few minutes, but we'll all do our best with it. So we also have the Youth Wellness Council, which is Fuel Up to Play 60 group as well from Bartersville. And I'll let you guys, you want to talk a little bit about, introduce yourselves. Okay.
Should we stand?
You can stand, well, whatever you're most comfortable with.
Hey everyone, my name is Jillian Freeman.
My name is Olivia Terman.
We are from Bartersville Middle School.
However, we started at Bartersville Elementary School.
We have done numerous big activities throughout the years.
Those include NFL meet and greets,
healthy top chef competitions,
milk drives,
food label lessons, so much more.
For over 5 years, our goal has been to keep our community healthy.
So, we are going to take you on our journey with us.
Thank you guys so much. George Washington Fed Up program.
We're a club leader here, Elizabeth Wirtz. And I'm actually going to let her tell you a little bit about it, and then I'll catch up on the end.
Okay. So, my name's Elizabeth, and a few of my friends and I started a healthy living club at our high school at the beginning of the year. And at first, we didn't really know what we were doing. We were just kind of like, this could probably help the community in some way. So, Mr. Cassis came to us and he was like, have you ever seen the movie Fed Up? And we were like, no. And so he told us about the Fed Up movement and how they were showing this movie in a lot of schools in West Virginia, and we wanted to get involved. And so we got together a bunch of classes and they showed the movie Fed Up, and it's about like childhood obesity and just like how you can overcome it with eating healthier. And so we got involved in that, and PBS came and filmed us after watching the film because a lot of students were really inspired. So we started a school garden because we thought that would help improve the school's like health and just like the community. And so we just got permission to actually get that food into our salad bar at school. So we're really excited about that. And we also really want to get like a water fountain that you can have filtered water in and put like buy water bottles and use that for the filling of water bottles.
Awesome. Yeah, that's kind of where we're going with it now. And Keys for Healthy Kids, they were a tremendous help to us. You know, Dr. Jeffrey, she's been there step for step with us. In fact, she's kind of the driving horse. And then these kids, you know, the group that does this, the Healthy Living Club, they have really, it was amazing to me to see how much they fully took on this responsibility. It's a huge responsibility to get this garden going in the first place, and then to keep it running through the summer. And by the way, through the summer here, they're taking the food that they're growing. It's being donated to Manna Mill, and help feed homeless people in Charleston. But this group's been great, and the best part about it is They do all the work. That is, that makes it great to work with them.
That's awesome.
That's our group.
Awesome, thank you. And then, how about we have our Mako group just introduce yourselves and just give a little bit of a why you're involved.
I'm Kayla, this is Kendra and Danny, and we're the representatives of Mingo County. And our group is called GLOW, and that stands for Guys and Girls Leading Our World. And it started whenever Lida, she's in the blue, she came to our school and she called down most of the girls and just put us in a room and like made us do activities. And she said, some of y'all can stay or you can leave or whatever. And I thought it was very interesting of how this woman just came into the school and took over. So I really liked that. So I stayed, and I'm the president of the group. And we just help our school and our community. And we help do field days. We do stuff. We go to the legislators. We've been to the Capitol. I've been to Georgia and South Carolina to help with Habitat for Humanity, and we just do a lot of stuff in the school to help get physical activity going.
Thanks, Kayla. And someone from our Logan group, can you guys just introduce yourselves and talk a little bit about FAPS? Just the short, quick and dirty version.
I'm Kiana Minter, and I have two other group members, Destiny Workman and Tiana Sherman. We're new. This is our first year of BAPS, so we're not really sure how it started, but what we basically do is we're kind of do some of the stuff they do. We talk to legislators, go against bills that we don't agree with, or and we work in a community garden that we actually just started working on not too long ago, a couple months ago. And we're trying to get that started and going and get more people to come to the garden and eat healthier.
Wonderful. Okay, great. Thank you, guys. So I kind of want to start with the Barbersville Electric Play 60 group and ask you guys to talk a little bit about, like, what problem were you trying to solve when you started the group? Like, what was the big thing you were like, we have to change this?
Okay, the big thing that we're from Huntington, which at one point was like the fattest, most obese city in the country. And so we were just really trying to make an impact against that.
Great. And what are some of the things that you guys have done? And Jenny, you didn't get a chance to introduce yourself yet. You want to pop in there?
Sure. I'm Jenny Anderson. I'm their program advisor for Fuel Up to Play 60. So I basically started inviting third, fourth, and fifth graders to be a part of the group. And I think that there's a lot of times elementary school leaders are overlooked, and I feel like that's where you start that leadership skill going. And these young ladies have been with me. They're going into seventh grade now, and we really started focusing on nutrition more than anything, trying to make that better and raise awareness in the school. We have a lot of, there's a lot of diversity in the school, kids coming from different walks of life. Our school was eating in the cafeteria, and it switched to breakfast in the classroom last year, so these ladies were instrumental in helping the school make that switch. And one of the things that we did was we started a physical activity program in the cafeteria where they used to be eating in the morning. That room was vacant, so we started a program called BTP, Village Shuttle Package. And I'm going to let the girls tell what we did and talk about the different components of physical activity and how they did it.
In the morning, instead of just sitting in the cafeteria, we kind of do physical activities to help stay active. And we've also done like food label lessons too to help kids read food labels and really know what's in their food.
And like some of the stuff that we found out that we didn't know as we were teaching that lesson surprised both of us. So while we were teaching, we were actually learning.
Awesome. Awesome. Thank you guys so much. So I think that one of the biggest things we all run into for youth groups, for any type of like community, coalition, group that you're trying to keep together, is how to like sustain that momentum. How like you originally might start, like everybody kind of is, by responding to a problem in the community, whether that's like a need for more leadership programs, more drug prevention programs and things like that in the community. But sometimes it can be difficult to sustain momentum, throughout the years and keep people interested. So can I have just one of the groups, would you like to respond a little bit to like maybe one of the groups that have been going for a little while about how you think it's like, how you keep momentum up and keep people interested?
We can do it, I guess.
You guys want to go?
Yeah.
We sustain our momentum by
being positive,
determined,
and never giving up.
We will face obstacles
and roadblocks,
but we know we must always keep our heads up.
Oh, very nice. Thank you. And I was reminded, too, to like speak up so that people in the back can hear, too. I know it's pretty far back, the room. Okay, how about, like, can I get a really good example, maybe from the Logan group, about an obstacle that you've encountered and some of the ways, and it could be something that you're still working on, like working through, but an obstacle you've encountered and how you've tried to move past it.
Well, we've been working to get a youth center, and one of our obstacles about that is we want something really close to our school because it's kind of like, we call it an island. And we want something close to the island so kids could walk after school, because we don't have many, activities to do besides like school sports. So we're trying to get that, but what we've done so far, we've looked far away. We try to stay positive, look for more buildings, call places.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Does anyone else have one?
What's our problem?
Yeah.
In our high school, what you find is our kids are extremely busy. They're extremely busy, and they set a very high standard for their academics. So it's tough to be able to pull them away from that or their extracurricular activities after school. So what I'm trying to work out with my principal for next year is some built-in time in the schedule during school time, so kids can come out, be a part of this. It's something a lot of kids have an interest in, mm-hmm. but it's not something everybody can get to.
Yeah.
So that's been our biggest obstacle, but I think we're working it out. We'll learn some new skills next year.
Definitely. Yeah, I think every youth group up here is a school-based one. And there's a lot of probably shared difficulties, and people in the room I know too, shared difficulties we all encounter in working with schools that are wonderful but are also so busy and underfunded and, all that stuff too. So I look forward also to hearing from the audience about some of your experiences working with schools and overcoming those obstacles. So any other obstacles you guys particularly want to talk about? Mingo group?
There's the school that I just graduated from. We didn't have a lot of physical activity, and the school only requires 1 year of PE, which I think kids need at least 30 minutes a day of physical activity to get the blood flowing in them, so when they do go back to class, they'll calm down and actually pay attention to the teacher. So I started a fitness club at my school, and we had it every Thursday at lunch, Mod B. And we did yoga, kickball, and we was just getting it started this year, so we had a few rough patches. But other than that, it turned out pretty good. And we did the Fuel Up to Play 60 this year too. And we won a field day for having the most active school in the county. And we just recently did a field day at the school where we had volleyball, the Gaga pit, which we had our tables instead of like an actual pit. So that was pretty interesting. And we had relay, tic-tac-toe,
twister,
four square, And the kids really seemed to like it. And they was actually interested in getting up and moving and having fun. And they don't really get that at the school. So that's one of the biggest problems at Toad Valley.
Awesome, thank you. And we can come back to any of these when we have questions as well. But one thing when we talk about youth-led and adult-sponsored groups, like one of the most important balances that you need to strike as an adult mentor is like, how do you give your students enough space to grow into leaders and not swoop in and always try and do things when it might not be going as well as what you'd like? So as we have youth experts here, I'd love to spend some time talking a little bit about what you need from your adults in your life that want to help support you grow into leaders. And it might be about how to communicate, what communication is best for you, like, you know, meeting new people and connecting to people, resources, or just like being quiet sometimes, like maybe I need to be right now, you know. So just, yeah, whoever would like to kind of start us up talking about what you need from your adults. Yeah.
One thing that is helpful in our situation, we have Mr. Cassis, and he's actually a health teacher. So he, like if we have something that we want the students to know about, that we want to get out to the students, we can bring it to him, and then he can like tell his classes, like the Healthy Living Club is doing this, you should get involved. So that's brought in a lot of people to our club, just having him kind of as our advertiser.
Yeah, that's a great strength. Do you guys want to kind of go down the line, maybe?
I feel like our adult mentor, really just Jennifer, she always wants to do things. Like, she never says, you know, no, we shouldn't do that. We always find a way around the obstacle. And she really helps us with that. So whenever we're stuck in a problem, she definitely comes through and helps us. And that's what we need out of it.
Mm-hmm. One thing you really need to remember as an adult mentor to youth groups is that you have to allow them to make mistakes. You're supposed to support them on whatever they're trying to do. And even if that thing they're trying to do might fail, they're going to learn from that failure, and then they're going to grow from it. So you have to be willing to let them make mistakes and just kind of watch them do it, even if it burns them.
That's very well put. Yeah. Thank you. Kendra, Kayla.
I think that sometimes, not only adult mentors, but adults sometimes in general, when kids are speaking about sometimes like serious topics or how to get things started, like, oh, let's get more physical health in our schools. Sometimes adults don't take kids seriously where they're kids. And I think that if you have an adult mentor or an adult in general, they need to sometimes look at a kid as more than just a kid, because sometimes they try.
I agree with what everyone has said so far. It's very important for adults to help the kids in the groups, and not just the adults, but the teachers and the staff members at the school. Because if you go to a teacher and you're like, hey, I want to get this started, I'm very passionate about it, and they're like, oh, well, that's not really going to work out, then what if that was your one chance to get something great started in your community, and that one teacher said no? So I just think that the kids need support from the adults and teachers.
Mm-hmm. Yes, definitely.
I believe we need the adults to push other adults to help us, because I'm like Kendra, sometimes adults won't listen to kids. They think that they're just talking just to talk. But if you have someone to back the kid up and go along with what they're saying and have a great plan planned out and to explain it to them, I believe that what you're trying to do will succeed.
Yes, good advice. Destiny and Tiana, do you have anything to add about what you need from your adults? What you wish you could tell anonymously? I can leave the room if you want.
I just think they need to be there for encouragement.
Be there for encouragement?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
I want to ask each of the groups to kind of give a little bit. We've already started talking about why health is this driving motivator for you guys to rally behind. But I want to hear a little more about that. And, you know, if you have personal reasons, because, right, everyone comes to a cause for, like, maybe we have a lot of similar reasons, but we might have some different ones, too. So do you want to start over there again, talking a little bit, like, what your personal motivators, why health is one?
Well, for a lot of people, after watching the Fed Up film, a lot of the kids were, like, fed up with big fat industries, and they, just, like, how big fat industries targets the youth with their, like, McDonald's commercials and stuff, and that's the reason a lot of our students are unhealthy and overweight and, like, have diabetes, and so a lot of our students were basically really not happy. They were fed up, so that caused a lot of people to want to get involved in our Healthy Living Club. Mm-hmm. And personally, I was pretty fed up also, so that's kind of my motivation, just being mad at big fat industries.
Yeah, anger's good. Anger's great. Anger is good. Okay, do you guys, what are your personal reasons?
It's physical health, but it's mental health as well, since they both ran together. I'm somebody who has pretty bad depression, so if I really do want to go out and get fit and healthier, I just I don't feel like it. I'd rather just heat up some rain noodles and get on with my life. And whenever you're doing a group like we have in our school, you feel like you're actually a part of something. And when you feel like you're a part of something, a little bit of that depression is going to go away. And you're more likely to get active. You're more likely to feel like, you know, you can actually do something. Like you can take control of your own life and make it whatever you want it to be.
Awesome.
I don't really have a personal reason. I was kind of just at band camp, and she was like, come to this meeting. And I was like, oh, okay, I'll come to this meeting. And I didn't really know what it was about. And then I went, and I was like, oh, this is cool. And I kept coming to the meetings.
That's valid. That's really valid. Yeah. Sometimes that happens, too.
Yeah.
But she kept coming. So
yeah. Let's walk in. Let's bring snacks. And
Not pizza.
No, pizza
sometimes.
You can edit that out.
No problem.
But I personally have a story, which I always have a story. But I was bullied growing up, as you probably know. This is how I am, but I am 100% healthy, and nobody believes it, but I proved them wrong by being in this group. I started a physical activity group at my school. I did a 5K, which nobody thought I could do, and I did it with her. She was there for proof. I have pictures. And I can go out and do most stuff more than a football player kid. Half of them can't go run a 5K. Half of them can't go out and do most of the stuff that I did. I went to Georgia and South Carolina with the Habitat and Humanity, and we worked at a shop where we had to carry lumber and sell stuff and price everything, but we had to build stuff too. And that's hard work when you're carrying like a 200-pound piece of wood by yourself. You get pretty strong, but people don't believe that people my size can do stuff like that, so that gave me the fire to prove them wrong. So that's why I'm very passionate about the physical activity at my school.
Thank you.
Personal story is, people, like my grandmother, she's not in amazing health right now, and I realized, like, I do not want to be like that. I don't want to be in that same situation, so that's kind of my reason.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I wouldn't want other people to be like that.
Yeah.
or out of shape, or they can't be, their life will be shorter or anything like that. Mm-hmm. We want people to live longer, be healthy, be happy, like her. It affects not only physical health, but mental health.
Yes, well said. Do you guys have any personal motivators that make you want to do stuff to get your community healthier? No, it doesn't come to mind. Okay, come back. Okay, so a couple questions before we go to questions from the audience for our adult mentors, Jenny and Lewis, and also me, and anyone else. I'm sure there's many more tons of people in this room are adult mentors. But to you, like, what does youth-led and adult-facilitated really mean? And as a mentor, how do you make sure you're making space for your students to take on new roles and responsibilities? Any like tips of the trade that you guys have? Jenny, do you want to start?
Well, what it means to me is exactly how it sounds. They lead. They're the ones that are coming up with the ideas and the plans, and I'm there to kind of oversee it, you know. And if they, of course, help them out with obstacles and things like that, you know, these two girls are very good at what they do. They wanted to teach at our school's Healthy Lifestyle Day. We usually have professionals come in and present. They wanted to present. So I went home, and this is one example of how you should let them go. Mm-hmm. I went home and prepared a lesson for them, thinking, oh, well, they probably don't know what to do or whatever. Mm-hmm. I walked into the school the next day, and they were totally prepared, had done their own thing. They taught was it pre-K through 5?
Yeah.
I mean, 5th grade, and did an amazing job in front of each class and all day, and they kind of modeled it for each grade level. So there's really not much work I have to do, you know. You know, the Healthy Top Chef thing, they came, you know, Jillian actually came up with it, and she came up with specific things she wanted to use as the requirements to do the Healthy Top Chef. You know, all foods had to be 5 food groups. They had to look good. They had to taste good. I mean, they do it on their own. They really do. And I just kind of, you know, her mom, Jillian's mom, has worked with me as well over the years, and we just kind of let them come up with the ideas, and they have helped them. Yes, they do. So, I don't know. As far as tips, it's just listen to them and hear them out. You know, some of the ideas might be so crazy and silly, but there's always a way to do at least part of it and help them do it. So, yeah.
Awesome. Yeah. Very good tip. Yeah.
I think we almost have a natural leadership situation just because, in all honesty, I'm not really available all the time to these guys. They really have taken the initiative. They took the initiative to get this club started. I wasn't any part of that. I wasn't, at the beginning of the year, I wasn't even their sponsor. And they said, hey, we've got this club. And a couple of my students told me about it and said, we'll see what we can do with it. But, you know, I sponsor a couple other clubs. I'm there. I coach sports. And not to mention, I teach 7 health classes a day. So as far as the balance between us, it is, they really, I'm not kidding when I say they do all the work. They do just about the bulk of the work. And then, yeah, certain things, you know, if they need permission to use the planning boxes that we had out behind the school, that was something I could go help them with. Or if they need supplies for their garden, that's something I can go pick up in my car. Mm-hmm. It's really, other than that, they've taken the initiative, and they're the reason that the group has lasted throughout. I mean, it's really not something that's going to go away. You can see it. Actually, I've got 2 of my other students back here in the back of the room. I'm hoping they're going to carry this on next year as well. And former student right here, by the way. Small world. But really, it's what they want it to be. And it's tough for me. I'm a coach, so I see parents, and I'm always, we always talk to parents every year about, stay out of it, let the kids do what they got to do out there, let them, they're having fun, so let them do their thing. And for us, it's kind of the same thing. They're trying to make their dreams, their goals come true. I don't think it's fair for me to interfere, which it can be really tough at times. Cause I've been through a little bit more than they have so far, but to let them do it, to let them have that responsibility. I think somebody said it earlier. You've got to make mistakes to see what works. And I've been. That's usually when I call Dr. Jeffrey and say, hey, they're getting ready to do this. Are you sure about this? Should they be doing this? And just stay out of it. Okay. So anybody that knows her can vouch for that. I'm sure her daughter could right here. That's really, I can't say I've done much with this group. They've really taken it. They've run with it. And then I just kind of expand on it where I can. Like she said earlier, I do. I see 300 kids a day. Most of them are freshman students, and it's part of my curriculum. I'm doing it anyways. I can make it a little bit bigger, a little bit better, and, it's a lot easier to tell a kid in class, hey, this affects all of us. We're all in this together, and here's something you can do. Here's actually something. I'm not just up here preaching to you. There's something you can do. And they turn out to be a great option and have a great lead.
Thank you. Yeah, that's great. I agree with things both of you have said. I could learn a lot from both of you. I'm still learning a lot in this job. I've only been here a year, but I don't love anything more in the world than working with young people, because it really is exactly what you guys have said. It's like, get them the opportunities they need, get them to the place they need to be, like here, right now, and then like stand back and let them absorb, learn, everything. And I think that it is kind of an instinct as an adult when you, we remember high school, we remember, and younger than that too, and we remember how difficult it was, and you don't want them to be disappointed if something doesn't work. But absolutely, you don't get very far if you're always like shooting lower than what you actually want to do. And I think that by nature, a young person kind of just like sees things bigger. They see the world a little different, and it's wonderful to see it that way with them, that everything just seems like more attainable. And I think it becomes attainable when you start seeing it that way. And we can talk more about that when we get questions from the audience, but one more thing I wanted to ask to our adult mentors that are here is, you get these amazing leaders that spring up. What happens when they age out? Hopefully you're growing, you're recruiting each year, but recruitment is sometimes easier said than done. So what are some of the tips that you have for, trying to make sure that each year you're not starting from scratch when people age out?
Well, I believe some of them are in the back of the room somewhere.
Yeah, my recruits. Like I said, when you fill up to play 60, you can ask the whole school to make a pledge, all the kids. What are you going to do this year that's going to keep you healthy? What are you going to do? Are you going to ride a bike? Are you going to eat more vegetables? Are you going to help your mom cook? Things like that. So I start that with kindergarten. And then by the time they're in third grade, they know what Fill Up to Play 60 and the youth wellness council are all about. Groups, and then they have to apply for those spots. And, they can do it any time of year if the spots aren't filled. We've got 10 fourth graders and 10 fifth graders involved in the wellness council. They're the leaders. They're the ones that are help planning things and all that. So, it just kind of keeps going from there. And then there's the flip side of middle school. We've had a horrible year and hit obstacle after obstacle. And so a couple of those guys back there are getting ready to go into middle school. For example, we started a youth wellness council in the community.
Amazing. Briefly, sorry, briefly.
classes and dance events and things like that. These girls love to dance. So it's still going to give them an individual family. So that's kind of how we're working around all the obstacles with the school. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of how I recruit. I started now.
Yeah.
Getting the word out there.
That's great. Yeah, start young.
I'm not going to lie, I'm sitting up here stealing your ideas right now. Thank you very much. We're a brand new group. We just started in September, I think is when I got hooked up with you guys. And for me, I think we're going to kind of go in the opposite directions. You know, you guys are starting at the elementary age, we're starting at the high school age. So I think eventually what we're going to have to do is bring our elementary school kids up and start a mentoring program, something like that, and actually whatever they decide, then that'll be their choice, their decision. But I think if it's something that we want to last, that would be the same type of thing. I think if there's somebody at that age that are learning these skills and learning why this is important, I think that makes it, when they get to high school, that legacy stays, that legacy continues. So that, you see it with sports all the time. People have, we're starting our basketball camp on Monday. We'll have our youths up there, coming through the school, and about 80 kids up there, and those kids understand what it means to be on that basketball team by the time they're at the high school. Your boys, I love them. So it's the same way with us, I think. But like I said, I'm writing as I go here. I'm learning. I've already picked up so much at this conference; it's ridiculous. But that's what we're doing.
Awesome. Young people, do you have tips for recruiting? Sometimes I guess you just stumble in and it goes well.
I think like targeting the younger kids, like this year, a lot of the freshmen were looking up to us. Like, I think they thought it was really cool. So like targeting like the younger, like the freshmen at least, like even though they're not that young, just like talking to like the freshmen, maybe at orientation or something, like say like this, maybe show like a slideshow like of what we've done, get them interested.
She's only a sophomore and she's talking about freshmen like they're
a little guy.
There's something I'm hearing you all talking about all this. It sounds like you're using so many really advanced skills in development and going off of your strengths. There's nothing like for an elementary or a middle school young person to have a sophomore take interest in them. And for a sophomore to come to them and say, hey, I see something about you that would be great in this program. Yeah. You're the ones that are going to catch them. And for the adult leaders, I think that for us to be able to see that in our leaders in front of us is, hey, we need your help because I'm going to be here, you're going to be here running these groups or assisting with these groups, but the leaders will be gone. But they can develop the new ones coming up, and it makes everything run so beautifully. And when you walk into a room full of folks like you all, where there isn't a divide between seniors and freshmen in terms of who's allowed to talk to who and that kind of thing, it's just so nice. And for those younger people to come in and feel respected and wanted, you're doing a fantastic job. Fantastic job.
Thank you. Yeah. Any other tips about recruitment? And
I would say if you have any siblings, start to talk to them, because I have a little sister and she came. I was like, okay, we have to work in the garden today. And she got off the bus home from school and she came straight to the garden. She's interested in what we do because she likes what I do. So she wants, since she likes what I do, she'll tell her friends all the cool stuff and that we get to do. And then they'll want to join. So I would say start with your siblings.
Did Christiana?
Yeah, that's how I got interested. My cousin, she was in the group before, and I kind of winged on to her.
Do you guys have any tips before we let the audience ask some questions?
Peer pressure.
Especially if it's someone like a senior like Kayla. Like, she came to me and she's like, hey, come to this meeting. And I was like, if I don't come to the meeting, I'm either going to die or I'm just going to not live. Like, I don't know what I'm going to do. So, like, it's not a nice thing to do.
But
it could work if you were in need of dire last minute, like, resource.
Yeah. But I think the tip is to go out and literally just ask people. Tell them about the group. And tell them all the fun things that you do and how you're going to help them. Like, you'll get scholarships for college. You'll get known in the community. And that might lead to, like, a higher power of somebody. You might get to meet people that you never thought you would. So I literally just went in the cafeteria and, like, made everybody shut up. And was like, come to the meeting on Thursday. There'll be pizza. And I was like, pizza? And I was like, yeah, that's how I'll be there.
We don't always have pizza.
No.
I guess bribery also works, too.
Bribery works.
In moderation.
Like, hey, come to this meeting, we might give you, like, not only one packet of cheese crackers, but two.
It's like we need four cheese crackers.
Oh, yeah. Just need more cheese crackers as you go.
Or Capri Suns.
Okay, so audience, a lot of you probably are here because, you know, you want to, like, meet all the wonderful people here, but also, you know, learn more about how to get youth more involved in what you're doing, whether that's in the school, community, whatever. So do you guys have questions for our young people or for our mentors or anything to share? Yeah.
I'm really interested in what you guys want to do after school. So I work with high school students in Southern West Virginia. And I strive, you know, the big thing that I do is help them solve a community problem through research. And so I'm always wondering what they're going to do with that once you're out of school.
I want to own my own food truck and go around and serve healthy food, but also have, like, some, like, bouncy balls and, like, hula hoops in the back of it. So if I stop somewhere and I see some kids, we can, like, go around and just have fun.
Kayla's fun truck.
It's going to happen one day, so if you see Kayla Bam's food truck rolling around, you know it's me.
Yeah. Whenever I graduate, I hope to come back and be like Jennifer and, like, help the kids in the other schools that I graduated from and go back and try to get the program, make sure it's still going there and be Jennifer and Jillian's partner anytime. That would be awesome.
I'd kind of like to be in the West Virginia government so that way people who are running these programs and stuff, they'll have somebody who's a little bit higher up who can help them get these things done. Might even be the United States government, who knows?
Well, I love that you guys are all wanting to stay in West Virginia.
Anybody else? Questions?
People about what you're doing. Do you, obviously the higher goal is to improve people's health, but do you feel like it's easier if it's sold as, like, this is a great group that's, you know, we all get to spend time together and hang out, or it's a social group, or we're going to do these activities? Do you feel like people of your age, is it positive to say this is something to help people get healthier, or are people turned off by that?
It's very challenging in Logan, West Virginia, to get people to come to our, whatever we do, because most people are like, no, I have something to do, or I want to do this, and it's not like physical activity, but once we get them to come, they'll start getting more interested in the things we do and try to be more active.
Yeah. I feel like I started it because I wanted to be healthy, but I didn't realize that I would meet people along the way who I actually turned out to be really good friends with, like Olivia.
Yeah.
I don't think the kids at our school really take health that seriously that much, because half of them don't even care about their schoolwork, so why would they be like, oh, I need to get in shape? Like, But I feel like that if you make... She called me a nerd. But I feel like if you found a way to get make things like that more interesting for the kids, they'd probably be like, oh yeah, let's go get it.
did you want to, yeah.
Me?
Okay. Whoever was there. I'm gonna say almost the opposite of what Jillian said. I think that people start like our program when kids are in the third grade they can join, and so I think to start they don't understand the meaning of like what it is to be healthy. So I think they start and they join the program because their friends are in it because it's fun. But then I think as they get older they start to understand more the value of health, and then they meet new people like Jillian.
Yeah, I would say, I would add, we do this at lunchtime, mm-hmm. and I'm sure they would all agree that's why they like to come. They like to come in there because they get out of the cafeteria to eat their lunch. They'll eat in the gym or they'll eat in the art room because mm-hmm. they have teachers that allow them to eat in there.
Pretty
marketing
materials for stuff. Different types of red tape. So one of the things that we do is we train our farmers not just in how to grow, but in how to jump through those hoops, right? So.
My name is Steven Smith. I'm the co-chair of Trilis West Virginia. One of the fringe benefits of helping to plan the conference is that I get to choose some of the sessions that, to facilitate. I signed up for this one real quick because I think this is sort of an all-star session. I'm going to talk very, very little other than to just introduce folks and move us along. The way this session is going to work is that you're going to hear for 10 minutes from each of our three presentations about what they were able to do. You've heard a little bit about each one already in the big session, so this is a chance for them to go a little bit deeper into what worked, what didn't, some of the barriers they had to overcome, etc. Then we'll take a little 5-minute sort of pause in the middle of the workshop where we want you to get a chance to talk to each other again and say what is the big thing you want to do. Presumably you're all here in this room because there's some big thing you want to do. And then for the last half hour, we'll take your questions about how you can do that thing, or specific questions you have about how they did their big thing. And then we'll wrap up about 4:00 and run everybody over to the Performing Arts Center for the last session of the day. Sound good? All right. Thank you guys all for being here. Thanks to our panelists for being here. Are you ready for us? One last announcement before we get started. Can someone lift up the sign-in sheet? Okay, and then can you raise your hand if you have not filled out the sign-in sheet? Okay, let's whip that thing around. And then about halfway through, we'll send out the evaluations as well, which are hugely important. The evaluations and the sign-in sheet are how we pick what sessions to do next year. So please make sure to fill out both of those. So the sign-in sheet will be going around. Keep an eye out for it. And I am thrilled to turn it over to Kathy Brunt, who you met this morning.
Do you want me to stand?
I don't think you need to. Whatever you feel comfortable doing.
Yes, I can't. thank you so much for having us. Wyoming County Students Against Destructive Decisions was formed in 2011. And I shared a little bit of our story this morning, and I tell everyone, there's a scripture that says, despise not small beginnings. And a lot of us want to go out and we want to, you know, rescue 2,000 youth, but you can't get them all. You can't get personal with that many starting. So don't be reluctant to start with 2 or 3. And, you know, we started with 6, and honestly, getting on the phone saying, do you know a youth that would be interested in youth leadership? And we got 6th, 7th, and 8th graders. Those 7th and 8th graders are juniors and seniors still in our program, but we have now grew from 6 to 600 SAD members. If you heard me this morning, I said that, you know, I could not get into the schools. They really did tell me no. They said they did not want another club, but neither did I. I didn't want another club. I wanted a movement. I wanted, I'm so old that I'm cheesy, like I'll try to be cool and the kids just laugh and pull a bit at me because I would say, you know, I want to uncool drugs. I want to uncool drinking. I want to uncool these things. But I didn't know what I was doing. It's forming SAD. It's a national organization. If you go to SAD.org, you're going to find 10,000 chapters throughout the United States. West Virginia SAD is growing stronger every day. We actually have over 50 students going to the national conference in Pittsburgh. I say all this about SAD to bring you to how we got the youth centers. The reason we received a building was because our students had no place to go. And at a meeting 2 years in, we said, what will create the change that you want? And they said, we have nothing to do. Kids go to bad neighborhoods, hang out at the bad houses because there's no healthy, safe place to go. And that's when I said, go get a building. And they was like, what, us, get a building? I was like, absolutely, if you want it, you go ask. And then I will help pull in the finances and I will offer you the support. So that's exactly what happened. Within a week, we were given the choice of two buildings. And one was in Oceana area and one was in Pineville. And if you're familiar at all with the Appalachian Mountains, that's actually far away when you gotta cross mountains and go around curvy roads. And there is no public transportation in our county. So I asked them to give us the central building, which was in Pineville, our county seat. And I was just thinking it would be easier if we're centrally located that the youth could come. I walked in this building and truly, there were mice going everywhere. At the back of the building, it was like it was an old feed store and they had left the feed and everything. So the mice were just having a blast. And I walked out of there, it stuck. I was like, what in the world? But I could not get past that the promise I had made that I would never see another Chad. And for you who don't know my story, it was my son's very best friend since kindergarten and he had just about lived at my house. And at age 19, I seen him in a casket. And I was like, what could have I said? Because I seen him going the wrong way, but I was trying to just, you know, be that cool mom and not be too pushy and push him away. Mm-hmm. But now, from then on, I was like, I will say something to these kids if they are making destructive decisions. I will say, you don't have to do that, come with us. And it has grown beyond my belief, beyond what I can imagine. When we received the building, we had no funding. I had no idea what we was gonna do. I just started applying for grants, many grants here and there. And do check out foundational grants. Check out the companies in your area. Appalachian Power, I just wrote like a little letter of intent, asked them for $10,000. The lady called me back and said, we really like what you're doing. Would you care to write a grant for $25,000? I said, it'll be ready in 10 minutes. And I was just like writing, and I just increased them out. So with that, we cleaned the building. We were able to put up the walls, and somewhere on this, there are pictures of the actual building, and you've seen them this morning. But it went from a feed building with mice everywhere, with piles of junk, to these kids coming in and their parents. And there's, I'd love for you to come down. We have people come visit all the time, but there is chalkboard black walls that the kids go in and do creative art on. There are, through Appalachian Power, we purchase exercise equipment. We have martial arts going on every Tuesday and Thursday. We, just this week alone, I think we had five different things planned that will be outreach from that building. We have a softball tournament, we had a flag football with the state police and our SAD kids. We, of course, our 5K team, our biking team, there is always something. And it really is youth-led. And if I cannot, it's just, if you take nothing away from me today, let it be youth-led. Let them have the power to create that change, and it will blow your mind. Mm-hmm. They literally, if you just sit back, but you offer them that support, I have a rule, no criticizing, condemning, complaining. You give me 3 C's, I'll shut you down. You cannot criticize, you cannot condemn, you cannot complain. And we get in stressful situations, and we'll all pull ourselves back in. What's good? What come out of this good? Ever had an event and you just blew it? I had one that is hilarious now. We had a superheroes free movie night. That will cost you borrowing a projector, 2 white sheets, and a little sound system. Pull your kids into a park, throw it up on your wall at the house, you know, your outside wall, a free movie. We drew in about 200 families, and some had to sit on blankets and with their families. However, it's crazy to see, but we had this idea that superheroes should be there. Your little boy loves superheroes, yeah. Right? Yeah. So, Hulk, a guy who really is shaped like Hulk, comes. You know, one of my sad kids, Jason, comes, and he's going to be really cool and play with the kids, and then he goes down the slinky slide. I heard kids screaming, mommy's yelling at him. And I was like, oh no, scared those children life out of them. And I was like, that was a bust. We'll write that down. Never bring real live characters. Put little tie little capes on them, but never do that again. The new youth center, how we're getting that, and just cut me off whenever.
No, you're doing good.
I can talk forever about our youth. But the how we got the building with that one is, I kept being asked to come to town halls, and sometimes older people, and not you all, I'm sure, not you guys, but sometimes they will wear you out and come telling you how bad it is, how nothing will ever change, let's hang a door note on the door and say gone, you know, out for lunch or whatever. But, and this is what these town hall meetings, that's how they were evolving. Everybody complaining, yes, I know drugs are bad. My youth know drugs are bad, but they also do prevention in the school and reach 4,000 kids at least twice a year with substance abuse prevention messages. Yes, drugs are bad, but they offer alternatives that they could, you know, go do 5Ks, be in martial arts, all these things. We encourage them to be a part of sports. But anyway, the third one, this has been my third time at a town hall meeting, and this time they actually invited my youth to speak. Again, let your youth talk at these things. Put your youth out there, give them that voice. Then you'll be surprised at what they can actually produce far better than me. And you know, they're learning to present at that age is just amazing. But anyway, in that presentation, it was all going downhill. Two of my youth knew that had to be roped back in, that they had to change the atmosphere. So one of my young men stood up and said, we're not gonna change anything if we all just sit here and complain, yep. Criticize, condemn, complain. He knew that was not right. So he asked all the people in the group to stand up and start doing some exercises. He did, I was like, oh my gosh, he did that. But some did, some didn't, and some looked at him like he was crazy. And then our next youth, he said, you know, we can help you change your area. Out of that meeting came, we asked again for a building. We were given a building. A member of a church volunteered to organize walking groups because everyone was complaining about the people on the streets that were doing drugs and how they would drive downtown and they would see drug deals. Excuse me. So they decided, and this is what's going on, there are 14 churches in our area, like within about 5 mile radius. And they called every church and asked them walk one night a week. So now we have church groups walking at least two groups during the week. And to the point that I was walking with their SAD students, and there was actually a drug dealer said, man, I can't talk to you right now. I can't do this. There's too many people. But I was like, yes, that's awesome. But it was people just taking action. The new youth center is on the other side of the county in Oceana. And it has all kinds of, like 4 families just piled everything in that building. But the good thing about that is they said if you want the building, you know, have a yard sale, and you'll get half the profit. And we've already sold $3,000 worth of stuff. Lots of antiques in there, just amazing things.
Kathy, let me interrupt you for a second.
Sure.
One quick question, and then we'll come back, let everybody go, and then we'll have more time for questions later. What's the biggest mistake that people make, you think, if they're, you know, trying to get a youth center or a community center started? What do you think is the biggest mistake people make?
Saying that they just can't do it and nobody will do it and it's just not possible. I hear a lot of people saying, I'm afraid I'll get sued. I hear that a lot. I can show you how to go, you know, to the Secretary of State, set your youth center up as a nonprofit organization. I mean, I'm sure a lot of people already know how to do this, but we actually purchased insurance through Nationwide, not just a plug for them, but I have like a $350 year premium that gives me $2 million worth of coverage for anything that we do. That's $350 I think I can spend.
Yeah.
And that you can raise that money through, we do road stops, the kids stand up and for superhero stuff in the middle of, you know, we're a small town, so we can do that. And we'll raise $700 within 4 hours. So there's ways to raise money. I would gladly sit down with you and tell you some things that we have accomplished. Airside students from Little Wyoming County last year was the national champions out of 10,000 groups. And I'm saying groups that were funded by Toyota, groups that got huge amounts of money. And here, our small Wyoming County sat about 20 to 25, you know, faithful students that come to the actual center. But what I was wanting to tell you about the 600 is this year, the superintendent, because of the national recognition, because of the positive things we do in the community, and some of that stuff is up there, she came to me and said, I want SADs in every school.
Mm-hmm.
Remember the back door?
Yeah.
And so we now have, we only lack one middle school, and there will be a SAD chapter in each school. That takes a teacher to start it up, and that teacher is busy, so you can get a parent or volunteer to go into that school and just help them do the activities. There are monthly activities you can do, but again, it makes it be visible, be valuable, and they will help you. Somebody, there's a group in, is Logan, did they get their building? There's been a couple of groups that came and looked at Ayers and went home and said, we can do this. We had a group come from Pocahontas, Webster, and Greenboro yesterday, and they're going home saying, we can do this. And you can, I promise you can.
Hold the thought. We're gonna have more time to talk, but okay. I wanna get through. So I'm sure there are questions. No. Hold the questions, we will have time at the end. I wanna make sure we have a chance to hear from the others. So again, the purpose of this session is to let you see a few different examples of how people just went and did something really big. Next up, we're gonna hand it over to Fritz. You heard Fritz's story and the story of the greengrocer in Alderson, and we've got a couple of.
Okay, well, I'll start out. And there's reason there's two of us is because we can get twice the time. What started this was more or less a vision from our church, First Assembly of God in Harrisville. Where the pastor and a few people in the church, two or three people, had this vision of looking at the gym and possibly doing something with it, which was owned by the town of Harrisville, because when the high school moved out and went countywide, this Harrisville High School was shut down and abandoned. So the town of Harrisville took over this building and operated it for about 10 or 11 years. They couldn't operate it, heat it, and they was more interested in reading water meters and whatnot, and I can understand it. So they just walked away from it. It sat dormant for about 11 years, from the year like 1999 to 2011. It was just sitting there. First attempt to go to the mayor to get it turned out to be a flop. About 2 years later, right around 2010 is when he was reapproached, and for some reason the doors just opened wide open and said, yeah, sure, you got it for 99 years for $1. So now we have this great big building. And I don't know if you have any pictures. pretty bad shape. Roof was leaking real bad. The hardwood floor along the edges was, as you've seen this morning, maybe in some of the pictures, is the floor, the basketball floor was up to here because of moisture caused it. It was really like kind of walking on an ocean. But we went in and took over and revamped it. We told the church, we really kind of, the church was backing this. We wanted some money, and they said, how much do you want? So, well, we got these 8 projects that we would like to do to get it open. And we give them an analysis and a rundown, a quote. So we'd like to have $52,000. And so that's what they fronted.
Yeah.
It was $52,000. God bless the church. They had, it was open. The congregation, the church, people didn't complain or whine or nothing. We told them we wanted our own board. We didn't want to run back for every decision when we wanted to buy a doorknob or something, go back to the board and make a $50 decision or a $500 decision. So we wanted our own checking account because we're going to have bills coming in from all directions, from suppliers and paying them and whatnot, and we didn't want the confusion of church secretary and us spending the money and all this, and they give us all of that. So it has run smooth since 2011 is when we started on it. We opened the doors January of 2012 in operation, and we've went through right around $300,000 in the last 4 or 5 years. Just gradually, just working. This is going to be a lifetime project for us because there's just a lot of things that we can do. We have our own church board. As I kind of explained that somewhat. It's small. We don't want a big church board. Or gym board. We don't like the name committee, so we're called the gym team. And we meet independently. No interference whatsoever from the church, although we do give them our financial statement. We're underneath the umbrella of the church, so the insurance is already all taken care of. We don't have to worry about 501c3 or any of that. It's all underneath that umbrella, and it works really smooth. The community was thinking some bad negatives about us during this process of doing this. But now the community is so used to us because we're not opening doors just for ourselves or for any, it's for the whole community from age 3 to age 103. Like Cheryl said this morning, the color of the paint in the gym is called neutral ground. And that's what we intend for the gymnasium to be, is neutral ground for all people. So I was at the beginning stages, I'm still on the board, and went through the first phases of construction and repair and whatnot. Then my part, I felt that I needed to step down to this level on that, because this guy here was the, kind of our program director and president of the board, and Andy will take care of from there to tell you what all we're involved in the community and the gym.
Right, I'm Andy Law, thanks for being here. Thank you all for doing this. It's been nice. Kate's been to the gym several times, and she makes a big fuss about it. And we're like, we don't see what the big fuss is about. But then you look back at the pictures and you see some of where we started, and you just kind of forget. But it's a pretty big project there overall. If you look back over from where we started to where we're at, this what she showed now is some of the events that went on up there. And they go on. That's our romper room inside the gym for the little ones, and it's right beside the fitness room so the parents can work out and see. We try to keep as much open space as possible. We don't like closed in areas, hidden areas, anything like that. There's a lot of events that go on there. When we started this, like Doug said before, we went to the town, we purchased the town, and it just kind of didn't, nothing worked out, you know, because the building was, everyone thought was condemned, but actually was just deemed unsafe. It wasn't actually condemned, but, and it was.